Hello, I'm Dr. Steve Kopecky, a preventive cardiologist at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. And this is another one of our episodes, interviews with the experts on preventive cardiology. It's a great pleasure to introduce my colleague and friend, Dr. Vlad Vasile, who is an assistant professor in cardiovascular diseases and also an assistant professor in the Department of Laboratory Medicine and Pathology. So welcome, Vlad.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kopecky. It's truly a pleasure for me to be here.
And Vlad is involved in both the measurements of lipoprotein A and in assessing patients that have high lipoprotein A here in the prevention clinic, which is our topic today on lipoprotein A. We're hearing a lot about it. We have drugs going through phase three trials that will hopefully show good things, reduction in cardiac events, and hopefully then be approved by the FDA. So Vlad, what is lipoprotein A?
Lipoprotein A is a lipid blood biomarker that associates mostly with the bad cholesterol, with the LDL cholesterol. It has a very strong genetic component, and we think that one in five people walking on the street, they have elevated lipoprotein A. Unfortunately, we currently don't have very good guidelines as far as screening for lipoprotein A, but I think the scenery is moving towards universal screening, so that's a good piece of information. Lipoprotein A in many studies shows that is in an independent predictor of atherosclerotic events such as heart attacks, strokes, and sometimes even death. And that's independent on all the traditional biomarkers of atherosclerotic risk, independent on the LDL. In addition to being a predictor of ASCVD, lipoprotein A has also been associated with other cardiovascular conditions, such as, for example, the most common valvular disease in the Western Hemisphere, the aortic stenosis. But more recently, we see studies that associate lipoprotein A with atrial fibrillation, with heart failure, and even with gestational hypertension complications such as preeclampsia, eclampsia. So I think it is a very important lipid blood biomarker.
That's fascinating. So if 20% of people have it, why do we have it? That if it's not good, it increases our cardiovascular risk. Did it used to be protective?
That is a very good question. I don't know the answer to this question. I don't know if lipoprotein A, we all have lipoprotein A circulating in the blood. And the majority of us actually have two isoforms of that, of this biomarker. The majority of the studies show risk at certain cutoffs. So if you exceed, for example, 30 milligrams per deciliter or 75 nanomoles per liter, then your risk will really start to increase. But the lipoprotein A is present in all of us.
So how does lipoprotein A increase our risk? What specifically does it do?
Lipoprotein A has two components, an ApoB and an ApoA component. One of these components, as I mentioned a little bit earlier, binds LDL cholesterol or bad cholesterol, transfers that bad cholesterol, and deposits this LDL in the intima of the arteries, including the intima of the coronary arteries. And so it contributes to plaque formation. The other component of lipoprotein A has a structural homology with fibrinogen, and in experimental models is a very prothrombotic component. So it makes your blood clot. Now, these two combined together, deposition of LDL cholesterol in the intima, and also the clotting, increasing the clotting properties of the blood, really make it a very risky biomarker. There is a dose response relationship between the level of lipoprotein A and the atherosclerotic risk, meaning that the higher the level of LPA, the higher the atherosclerotic risk. When we assess the cardiovascular risk clinically, we don't have very good tools currently to really tell us how much of lipoprotein A increases the risk. But there is a very recent study that I really wanted to mention here because I think it is important for clinicians, for practical purposes. A research group that looked in the UK Biobank at lipoprotein A, they used the ASCVD risk calculator and came up with a formula where you can actually plug in that ASCVD risk calculator and the value of lipoprotein A expressed in nanomoles per liter. So just to give you an example of a patient that I had last week, the ASCVD risk calculator was 2.1. But also this patient had an lipoprotein A in the range of 400. So quite an elevated lipoprotein A, 400 nanomoles per liter. And the risk really increased from 2.1% to 18%. So really you can see the additive effect of lipoprotein A using this formula. And I use it quite frequently with my patients, both to assess their actual risk, but also to show them that, okay, this is the risk that's additive and it's conferred by this lipoprotein A. This also has implications for the first degree relatives of the patients that I see because I recommend that they also are screened for lipoprotein A.
Fascinating. So you mentioned it's genetically based. So does that mean you can get a gene from each parent? And if you get one from each, it's higher than if you only get a gene from one parent?
It's a little bit more complex than that. The inheritance of lipoprotein A is unclear currently. And the reason is because we all have two isoforms circulating in the blood. Mm-hmm. And so these isoforms, they're different. Their masses are different because the number of kringles, one component of lipoprotein A has a certain number of kringles. The number of kringles really confers the mass of lipoprotein A isoform. And so it gets to be quite complicated. And I think the way LPA is inherited is not clear currently, because you can have, for example, somebody with an elevated lipoprotein A and their first degree relatives also have elevated lipoprotein A, but it's completely not at the same level. Meaning that the number of kringles is probably very different than the number of kringles in your proband.
So then the kringles, the tails, so to speak, on the LPA, when we measure LPA, we measure the mass. We don't measure the kringles or we don't measure the activity. Is that correct?
That is very correct. And that is the reason for which we recommend that the measurement of lipoprotein A is done in nanomoles per liter. The nanomole, the molar assay has more accuracy than the metric assay, the assay in milligrams per deciliter. None of them are perfect as far as accuracy, but we know that the molar assay is more accurate. And I also have good news in this respect. I think last week, the FDA has actually approved the molar assay in the U.S. So we already adopted that at Mayo Clinic, but this is now going to be more generalized throughout the U.S.
Oh, that's really great. Yes, we've been using it here for well over a year.
That's right. Almost 2 years. Yep.
So if we are measuring, you recommended measuring all first degree relatives. We just measure that once. And does an age matter? Can it be very young or should we wait until the child is 12 or 13?
That is also a very good question and has very practical implications. Frequently, I don't see pediatric patients, but the adult patients that I see and have elevated lipoprotein A, many of them have children. So one of the questions that they're asking, what should I do? Should I screen the children or not? And I recommend that their children get screened because lipoprotein A tends to mature throughout childhood. So it gets kind of stable in adulthood. So, but if the lipoprotein A is elevated in the child, then they should be treated. They should be seen by a pediatrician endocrinologist, and that should be addressed. However, if you screen the child and lipoprotein A is normal, you should screen the child again or the adult when they reach early 20s.
Do we know it can change then as they go through life?
There is some variability throughout the, generally speaking, overall, it doesn't change. There is variability from day to day, but it can also change with different events. For example, inflammation, some sort of a severe inflammatory condition can elevate lipoprotein A. We know, for example, that myocardial infarction is a milieu, a pro-inflammatory milieu that elevates lipoprotein A. It can also change with menopause. And so if you have somebody that is borderline lipoprotein A, you know, not really abnormal, but borderline at the upper limit of normal, we know that lipoprotein A is expectedly to be increased with menopause. So I generally test that patient that I see before menopause. I test that patient after menopause. And the reason is that estrogens tend to decrease the level of lipoprotein A. So when we're lacking those hormones, then lipoprotein A can go up.
Do we know the same about testosterone effects on LPA?
I am not aware of any data in that regards.
Okay. So,
but it is a good question.
And what about some of the common treatments we use, you know, statins, PCSK9 inhibitors? Do they affect it?
Yes, there is some data that shows that when you start somebody on statin therapy, their lipoprotein A will go up. But the caveat here is that it doesn't go up substantially. So we still think that patients will benefit from the statin therapy despite increasing that lipoprotein A. But again, the increase is not substantial to confer more risk for the patient.
So it won't take them usually from being normal to being elevated, unless they happen to be right on the border of 74, it may go to 80 or something like that.
Correct.
But not a big change. And then finally, you mentioned treatment. You mentioned aspirin. What else do we have and what's coming?
Yeah. Unfortunately, to date, we don't have very good treatments for lipoprotein, very impactful treatments. We do have the PCSK9 modulators, the PCSK9 inhibitors and the siRNA inclisiran. Both of them decrease LPA by approximately 25%. But these drugs have not been approved by the FDA for this particular use. And then if you have a patient that has a baseline lipoprotein A of 300, and you deplete that by 25%, you will still not be able to bring that risk significantly low in normal range lipoprotein A. So I would say we don't have etiologic treatments today. However, I think the future is very bright. We have at least five drugs that are currently being studied. Mm-hmm. Some of them have completed phase 3 clinical trials. Some of them are still in phase 2 clinical trials. And they're very efficacious at reducing lipoprotein A. Some of them reduce lipoprotein A by 98%. So very, very important drugs. And I think we will have them available probably in a couple of years, a year or maybe a little bit more. It's kind of hard to say, but we will have them available. I think the real question is, what should we do with patients with elevated lipoprotein A currently? Should we wait until we get these drugs or should we treat them? And I think the preventive cardiology community all agree that I think we cannot afford to wait. We need to treat these patients. And the way we treat them, we emphasize healthy lifestyle options, Mediterranean diet, systematic aerobic exercise. We decrease the LDL cholesterol, and we also consider starting aspirin on these patients if they're not at risk of bleeding to mitigate that prothrombotic risk. The way I tell my patients when I start treatment for this is, if I decrease the LDL cholesterol, lipoprotein will have less amount of LDL cholesterol to transport and deposit on the vessels. And if I decrease the thickening properties of lipoprotein A, I'm trying to counteract that effect with aspirin. Another thing that I think is frequently missed in clinical practice is not to forget to recommend screening of all first-degree relatives of these patients. with elevated lipoprotein A.
That is great advice, Vlad, and especially the importance of staying with lifestyle. We know it can reduce risk. It won't change the LPA levels, just like it really won't change LDL, but certainly can improve risk. So this has been a fascinating conversation. We're going to hear a lot more, I think, about this compound and certainly these drugs. We'll be back and talking with you, Dr. Vasile, I'm sure, in the not too distant future when these drugs come out and we're starting to use them to help our patients. So thank you so much for imparting your knowledge to us.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kopecky. It's been an honor to be here.
Well, thank you all for listening, and we hope to talk to you again soon.